I stopped and talked on Taiwan in August. I tried to, with Swedish comments and news in Swedish on Taiwan, and I tried to write something for you at least once a week.
Well, that's great.
Yeah.
That's great.
So, well, my daily work as a political editor, so I have my writing for this. So it's a wonderful page.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we have an hour more.
Yeah, okay.
I'm going to go on.
Well.
Okay, yeah, so let's proceed.
Yes. As far as I understand, you have not only a vision about Taiwan as an IT country, but also about developing democracy in new ways. Can you tell me?
Okay, so my main work since 1995, 96 or so, is on the idea of scalable listening. A scalable listening technology, broadly speaking, is any way to scale, meaning making more of the experience of people like you and I at the moment, having our focus on each other and paying attention to each other's state and having a real and deep conversation. This experience is great, but it doesn't scale more to, say, 20 people and end table, right? Beyond which we will need professional facilitators. But even the best professional facilitator can't hold more than, say, 150 people in a town hall. That's like the maximum. And beyond which we will need technologies to help us to still listen to people. And there's already technology that enable persons to speak to millions of people, like the invention of radio. So it enables one person, sometimes a dictator, to speak to millions of people. But there's no complex technology that enables one to listen to millions of people, or for that matter of fact, to have millions of people listen to one another. And that is until the advent of the internet. And the internet's original promise, if you read the like manifesto for cyberspace independence and things like that, was that people can use it to listen to people with different opinions and have a reasoned discussion and so on. And that kind of happens among the technical community, in the open source community, in the free software community, and then later on to the free culture community, including Wikipedia and other movements. But more and more, we're also seeing echo chambers and filter bubbles and things that reinforces one another's prejudice rather than having people to actually listen. It enables more people to have a very shallow, like a hashtag keyword experience of being listened to, but it's not the real authentic narrative or idea that was being listened, but just the subscription to some keywords or shallow opinions. So what I mean by scalable listening, I mean scaling out as in more people, scaling in more places, and scaling up, meaning more volumes, more conversations, and also scaling deeply, meaning a conversation of a higher quality. And so that's the three dimensions of scaling listening. And so I happen to think democracy as a way for people listening to each other to manifest into collective decisions that is non-controversial to everybody involved, and that can make it beneficial to everybody involved, at least without overt sacrifice for people involved. And so this is a idea of currently called open multi-stakeholder governance. And we use that for many, like climate change, like things that are so complex, we can't not use this method. But at the moment, where most of democracies are not using this method for domestic issues or issues of a local scale. And there's exceptions, of course, the Swiss with their referendums is a prime example. But in Taiwan, we're also having a new referendum act that is very Swiss-ish. And actually, it was an even lower threshold for conversation. So in Taiwan, a lot of those so-called direct democracy methods are being adopted, invitations, referendums, and things like that. And for me, I see my main vision as adding to it the depth, the breadth, the inclusion, the quality of conversation, as well as the people involved, the number of people involved, and scaling it in all the three dimensions so as to turn direct democracy into a more participative democracy. Yeah. That's my main vision. Yeah.
But isn't that the risk when you talk about filter bubbles and so on, that extreme groups, kidnaps, these groups and so on.
That's right. So it matters how we design the online spaces.
Yeah.
So for example, in all our online spaces for e-petition, for consensus making, and for petitioning, for example, we have people outlining their arguments pro and con, and assemble into different groups of opinions and reflections, mm-hmm. but we don't allow replying to each other.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. So there is no distraction from each other's arguments.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the only way to beat, so to speak, argument that you don't agree with is by proposing a better argument.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how we avoid wasting each other's time, because time is the most precious resource, and with time we can either generate distrust or generate trust. And in a collaborative space where people all add to something, that generates trust. And in a competitive space where people cancel each other out, that generates distrust. So we design our space as to generate trust instead of distrust.
And how does this type of democracy work together with the parliamentary
democracy? Mm-hmm. Right, so at the moment, because we're in the administration, we see the regulation making, which is a function of the administration. A kind of delegated power from the parliament, who define the basic laws on which regulations are developed. So the regulation co-creation with the civil society and with the private sector and with international friends, that is the main field in which it is undisputed, because the parliament already delegated the power of regulation level policy making to the administration.
Okay.
And so that is in fact our main work.
Mm-hmm.
But we also do more consensus making, deliberative polling, this kind of work to prepare drafts version of acts, because in Taiwan, the administration can propose drafts of a law to the parliament.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't have to be an MP to propose a draft.
Yeah.
The administration can also propose a draft, but in which case this participatory space is to save the fact gathering time and the reflection gathering time for the MPs.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like we do the preparatory work for the MPs.
Mm-hmm.
And MPs can have a much more deeper reasoned debate based on the initial consensus making work
mm-hmm.
that we prepare for the draft act.
Mm-hmm.
That played a factor in, for example, the platform economy, like Uber laws. But most of the time, let's say 90% of the time, we're working on the administration regulation level instead
mm-hmm.
of the law level.
Mm-hmm. And as I understand, all your meetings are public,
that's
like
right.
This one.
Yes.
That is very revolutionary, I guess,
mm-hmm.
in Taiwan.
Anywhere in the world.
Yeah. But
yeah.
What do other ministers say? What
mm-hmm.
What do the people in your administration say? They are
mm-hmm.
not used to this.
No. So it is not live streamed. We very rarely use live stream.
Mm-hmm.
We use live stream only when everybody in the room is comfortable with it.
Yeah.
As long as one person opposed to live stream, we don't use live stream.
But this is live stream, right?
No, it's not.
Okay.
It's not.
Okay.
So what we're saying is basically it is a co-created work.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have anything that you said that you don't want to be published,
mm-hmm.
It should be your freedom from
mm-hmm.
Surveillance, really. So that you can instruct our colleague doing the camera work
mm-hmm.
to say, this part of the utterance, I'm not confident.
Okay.
With releasing it to public.
Yeah.
So, and in internal meetings, normally we publish only the transcript, not the video recording.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And so the transcript, again, is collaborative edited for about 2 weeks
mm-hmm.
for our internal meetings before publishing
yeah.
it. And so this has three effects. The first effect is that in many meetings, people are so eager to speak, they don't really listen.
Mm-hmm.
So after they go over the transcript, they actually listen to the other side,
okay.
because it's very important.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing is that it provides accountability. For many people who see a policy being made, the administration is not as transparent as the Supreme Court, the court system,
mm-hmm.
or the parliament,
mm-hmm.
who all has a accountability trail of
mm-hmm.
what discussion led to this decision.
Mm-hmm.
But for policy level meetings, many times the administration just announced a new policy change, but nobody knows what was the discussion that led
yeah.
to the policy change.
Yeah.
So we're providing the accountability trail, much as the parliament
mm-hmm.
and the Supreme Court and the court system
mm-hmm.
is doing the thing. So it established people's trust in the administration to match the people's trust to the parliament and the judiciary functions. So that's the second thing, establishes trust.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the third thing is that it lets the professional public servant to share the credit Because whereas before, when a new policy is made, the minister takes all the credit.
Yes.
But all the actually working options are done by professional public servants. Mm-hmm. And if it goes wrong, the minister can always point the blame to the failure of execution of the public service. Right? So it's not very fair. Mm-hmm. But in this kind of environment, the public servant who proposes a new innovation, they get a credit because the journalists can go back to the transcript and see the actual agency and the person who actually proposed this revolutionary new social innovation, right? And
do the journalists really go back?
They do because in all my public speech, in all my interactive Q&A and so on, I do my best to credit my professional public service colleagues. And because this is a new way of policy making, if there's any risk associated with it, I absorb the risk because I introduced this mechanism. So this flips the risk reward matrix, right? They can share the credit and I absorb some of the risk instead of like the old better days where I would take all the credit and share the blame, right? So it's a different environment, and I found that in this environment, the public service are much more willing to make suggestions or innovations that could be risky because they know that I can absorb some of the risk.
Okay. But do these methods, now you are mm-hmm. controlling part of the government,
yeah.
can work on this.
Yes.
Does it spread to other
government? Oh, yeah. Because you see, in my work in open government or in social innovation, it actually crosses easily all the different ministries. Mm-hmm. So in all the ministries, we have participation offices who are like media offices or parliamentary offices, part of the administration that talk to stakeholders, right, instead of MPs or traditional journalists. And so these POs, they're used to this kind of working, and they are all over the different ministries. And in the social innovation tour, for example, every other Tuesday, I go to one of the four regional centers, and about 12 different ministry, about 20 people are in here in the social innovation lab, mm-hmm. while I go to the rural or indigenous or whatever places and use live streaming to talk.
Yeah.
And so they are now seeing with me as kind of the investigative journalist of the local social innovators' challenges. Mm-hmm. And many challenges are in fact created by outdated regulations. And so these people here, the ministry people, they're not just used to this kind of video conferencing and first front reporting with me as the anchor, but also is used to this kind of rolling co-creation so that they can respond very quickly to an actual problem faced by social entrepreneurs. And we make sure that it's all on track. And like within 2 weeks, they get a preliminary reply. And within 2 months, where I go back to the same place, it must have been resolved. Mm-hmm. And so this is a rolling system of multi-stakeholder governance. Mm-hmm. It is not just a one-shot thing.
Yeah. But is there any resistance?
Well, so far, because we're working on places where there could really be co-creative benefits,
mm-hmm.
we've met no resistance.
Okay.
And the reason why is that I don't really issue commands. If people are not comfortable with being published, for example, I once met a journalist mm-hmm. who wanted to take part of her speech from all the transcripts. So the transcript looks like me monologuing.
Okay.
and I'm fine with that. I don't really impose myself on other people. And so people decide for themselves
mm-hmm.
what kind of radical transparency degree they're comfortable with. And I think because of this, I've met very few resistance.
Okay. What do lobbyists think?
I'm sorry?
What do lobbyists think when they're...
Well, I think...
There must be a lot of industry leaders and some
yeah.
who want to meet you and still say that this is a little bit confidential.
Right. The lobbyists are... first, we have a law that prevents against misuse of power with lobbyists. So any minister is really required to keep a record if they meet lobbyists. Anyway, we have a lobbying act here. So what we're doing is just a much more detailed recording. So instead of just the summaries, we actually have down to the word level transcripts of meeting with lobbyists. Many lobbyists, I think, who approach me because I'm in charge of most social innovation, which means creating new values instead of redistributing old resources. So they're actually quite open of having their ideas and their business model, as long as it's not a trade secret, to be made public as part of the transcript, because they're really using me as a channel to meet people with synergies. And so I would often refer people who come to my office hour to previous people who have come to my office hour and say, the two of you really have some synergy. You can read that transcript and see how you can organize together.
Yeah, okay.
And so I think many lobbyists see it as a boon, because it's like free advertisement for them. And if they have any trade secret, they can just require to have that part edited out of the transcript anyway.
So Taiwan is becoming the most open country in the world because of government administration.
Yeah, if you just measure the maximum, yes. Yeah, it's not very equally distributed. What we're trying to do is to be the pilot, absorb the risk, and let the other ministries see that it really reduced some work and absorb some risk, so they can introduce at their own pace. So what we're seeing is that in a lot of like very controversial rulemaking, this kind of radical transparency is being adopted by rulemakers. But I would not say that this is now the norm for all public hearings or for lobbying. It is slowly being, the word I'm looking for is osmosis. There's a slow osmosis into the ministries and agencies. But in many regards, the local governments, the city level governments are still leading this kind of transparency over the central government, which are by definition and by tradition a little bit more towards stabilized policy making rather than a real quick response fix policy making.
I understand Taiwan, for me Taiwan is two traditions. One tradition is the history of Kuomintang in power, and the other tradition is the strong protest movement.
Yes.
Isn't that the correct assessment?
Well, of course, there's people who remember the martial law, and I'm like the last of people who remember life under the martial law. My brother, 4 years younger than me, doesn't remember the martial law anymore, and so he remembers the protest movements, but not the martial law and the ban on freedom of speech and assembly. So yeah, there's two generations.
If you should describe what the Sunflower Movement meant for Taiwan?
Oh, sure. The Sunflower Movement is a culmination of many different social issues. Around the Occupy, there's around 20 different NGOs, each focusing on one particular aspect of the cross-strait service trade agreement, CSSTA. And the CSSTA is pretty pervasive, right? It really touches on all the different parts of the society, so that people who focus on the environment, who focus on labor, who focus on specific trades, who focus on the Taiwan independence people, and the people who work on, for example, the grassroots, the liberative movement, and so on, all the different NGOs, they find their voice being, I would say, amplified and synthesized as part of the Occupy. Because in the Occupy, every NGO kind of had their own corner. And the people are like buzzing bees, right? The ideas spread from the NGOs to NGOs and synthesized by the people who participate in the Occupy and recorded and live streamed and gradually toward a consensus. And so it is one of the very rare Occupy steps because it has a social object at the core, right? There's this trade service agreement that everybody wants to make sense of, right? So there's many different tools and technologies and websites and other help systems that let people, for example, enter your company name or whatever, and it lists in plain readable form how the CSSTA affects you. And so this kind of things help the Occupy to focus on this common social object, rather than in many other occupies where it just become a cacophony of all the different social issues, right? So this is a very focused occupy. And so the demonstration is a demo in a sense that it is possible for 500,000 people on the street and many more online to gradually come to a shared understanding, not necessarily completely precisely correct, but a shared understanding of where we're going in regard to CSSTA. And so it has served as kind of a existential proof that this kind of crowd consensus making is possible. And not just possible, it is a lot of fun actually for a lot of people involved.
But if I was a traditional liberal, I would say that this you elect the parliament, they should be responsible to the electorate, and now comes the movement occupying the parliament and overthrowing the parliamentary decision.
Right.
Isn't that...
Yeah, but I mean, that was a very interesting
I'm
thing.
I'm not saying that I'm thinking I just put you in order.
Because at the time, the parliament was refusing to deliberate the CSSTA like any other foreign trade service agreement, because they constitutionally interpret Beijing as part of Taiwan. And so it's like a domestic agreement. They don't really need parliamentary oversight.
Okay.
It's at a policy-making level, rule-making, regulation level for them. It's not at a parliamentary level.
Okay.
So they kind of, I would say, abdicated their duty to deliberate.
Okay.
And so the people occupied and demonstrated how we may deliberate it in alternative fashion. So it is, I mean, a very specific and unique circumstance where the people are saying, you know, the MPs are not doing it, so we're doing it.
Okay. So the people said, okay, it's cooperating with China, but here's a different.
Yeah, there's this consensus of, for example, that it should be a due process, just like any trade service agreement with another country. Like Beijing should not, for the sake of this trade service agreement, be treated as a city government. It really doesn't make sense. And there's many other consensus items that's being gradually formed. And I think it's very symbolic that the head of the parliament at the time, the MP Wang Xinping, kind of just agreed on the final consensus point, and which is why people retreated. And it's widely seen as a victory, because the MPs are kind of picking up the ball from the people, saying, okay, we understand and we agree with the consensus.
Does Taiwan speaks mainly the same language as China? China is going in more and more authoritarian rule. They are quite close to each other. There are about millions of Chinese troops coming to Taiwan. Does this have an influence on China?
Some power. I mean, on the technology level, there's many technologies that deployed in the Sunflower Occupy that afterwards are deployed again in the Umbrella Movement in Hong Kong. And in fact, many technologies participated in both Occupy and with a shared technical stack. So that's on the technology level. Of course, the social circumstance and the outcome are very different. But it does create a broad solidarity between the Sunflower activists and the Umbrella activists. So that is a direct observation that many people have made, in the sense that using the same techniques just aligns people, right, with this kind of crowd democracy. I don't have any evidence that this has influenced activists directly in the Beijing regime. But we do see a lot of interest in the specific tools that we use for live streaming, for transcription, for coordination, for logistics, individually as civic technologies from people in the PRC. The civic tech movement in the PRC often refer to our work as an example that they can pick but use in their local context. But then the same is happening in many parts of in Asia and globally as well. So for that matter, it is not that different from any civic tech community anywhere in the world.
I read that you describe yourself as a conservative anarchist.
That's very right, yes.
But to be an anarchist means really that you don't have a government.
Well, yeah, but there's parts of different strands of anarchism, right? And they share a common, I think, core in the sense that we don't believe in command, right? We don't believe in hierarchies. We only believe in voluntary association, and we think any command destroys this peer-to-peer relationship, and only peer-to-peer relationship should exist. So if there is a governance model that is entirely peer-to-peer, open, multi-stakeholder, it could still call itself a government and still be properly anarchistic, right? But we're, of course, we're very far from there. But what I'm saying is that first, I'm demystifying how government works. So all those transcripts and so on is just a public education purpose to let people see the administration not as an opaque box, but as a set of mechanisms that people can freely replicate in the civil society. So for many social innovators, they are free to, for example, measure the amount of air pollution close to their homes without waiting for the Environmental Protection Agency to measure it. And they can also organize using the internet and distributed ledger technology so that they can share the data and collaborate with people from all over the world. And in a sense, this is governance. And in we in the administration work collaboratively with the civil society. In many different Asian countries, the government would try to control or limit this kind of legitimacy threatening civil association. But what we're doing is we're providing free supercomputing facilities, better quality sensors, so that people from all strands of civil society can compare their analysis on the same shared factual basis. So as to build trust, again, that's my main mandate, right? So this kind of collaboration, again, moves the function from something that used to be people imagined that only a government can do to something that social innovators can also do with the help from the government, right? So this is the model, the social innovation model that we're moving toward, where we solve the problem of the problem solvers, but instead of being, you know, the solver of all problems here. And so any step toward this direction make the society more anarchistic.
Okay.
And so that is where the conservative part means, right? Instead of destroying the state.
But
we're saying that we're taking approaches where every step is voluntarily accepted by the people involved so that the government can relinquish power gradually.
Yeah. Do you see a lot of your ideas could be used both locally and even internationally?
Yeah.
Do you get a lot of interest for what you are doing?
Yes, very much so. Yeah, we regularly hold webinars, and there's this kind of social innovation sharing occasion like this May. There's thousands of people coming to Taichung for the Tomorrow Asia and the presidential hackathon, for example, where we work with civil society and the public administration. We get an invitation from New Zealand where they want to invite the winner of the hackathon to come to New Zealand to solve the problem with their public service. So I think within the framework of sustainable development, there's many contributions that we can make individually. But the system we're working on is right here in the SDG 17, which is this international and cross-sectoral collaboration. And this system is what we get the main interest from city level government worldwide.
Thank you. Is it? I would like to make a short TV spot with you. Is that possible?
Sure.
Yeah, I just have to put up.
Of course. CSSTN. Cross Strait Service Trade Act. Agreement.
So we can follow this on the other two. So it's not because of the NIC. It's
because of
the NIC. It's not because of the NIC. It's
not because of the NIC. It's not because of the NIC. It's not
because of the NIC. It's not because of the NIC. It's not because of the NIC. It's not because of the NIC. It's not because of
它就會有很多按照條例來的。所以它只是
Act
的 implementation
所以它不需要调法律
像进入到它是自动
不需要调法律。
但是所谓当时所谓什么两岸什么什么的条约它的那个监督什么什么法案
不用，因为三二九号解释已经讲，然后而且之前 APA 就是用条约案的。
所以你的意思是说，即使我们通过什么两岸什么监督条例，在那个之后，通过了类似的法，
你可以比三十九号更严格，比如说要求所有的两岸企业，他们都需要知道一般。
对，因为我记得民间版就是
是
那种那个。
但是在那之前，陆委会主张，因为一直都是说，因为服贸协议就像开放市场这个清单一样，那它其实没有所有的FTA 或是所有的贸易协议都要进到一般，要看它有没有实质改变，
对，
改变税制这样子。但是服贸没有，因为它这个
是。是，就是说它的授权是当时 ECFA 的时候已经以法律层级给过的。
或没有，它是两岸条例里面的那个部分就已经是授权，
是
所以开放清单同时没有改变税率。
是，理解。那个脉络我理解。
对，所以我说它跟它是两岸协议或国际协议是没有关系。
而且你理解您的什么？哈哈
哈哈哈哈。
Your former title is Minister of Transport Forward.
Additional Minister.
Additional
Minister is a
full title. Digital Minister. Okay.
Or Additional Minister is a full title. Yeah.
Digital Minister all the time. You are recording the meeting here this time. Why?
So, what I'm practicing is for radical transparency. I'm trying to demystify the work of the minister, so that anyone in the civil society or indeed anywhere in the world can see how I'm approaching my decision making in any policy making purpose, so that people have the full context of the meetings that I've had, so that they can give me their suggestions or their participation or their opinions in a well-informed fashion. So all this is kind of material for a public well-informed civil society.
So a lobbyist that have a meeting with you get a request for it's okay that you record.
Yes, so the principle is this. If you live stream this meeting, I'm also live streaming. If you record this meeting as you're doing it now, then I'm also recording this meeting to be published under a Creative Commons license later. And if you just have a written summary, then I'm publishing just a written transcript. So there's a certain symmetry here. And also for the journalists and the civil society, this provides a very quick way to assess what I'm doing in a day-to-day fashion so that they can understand what kind of policymaking focus am I currently doing at the moment. So for the lobbyists, if they choose the transcript option, they're free to edit away the trade secret or any improper utterances they may have said or any incomplete sentences they have alluded to so that they can kind of change or edit it for 10 days, but just modifying their part instead of my part. So what I'm doing is on a voluntary fashion. I voluntarily publish all my utterances and meetings, but people participating in the meeting can, in this open by default setting, open the parts that they are comfortable with.
So your vision is that Taiwan becomes the most open government in the world?
Well, for me, the idea is to have this system where people can deploy and have this kind of transcription, this kind of publishing, this kind of searching and indexing. So it is not to compete with other parts of the world. All our transcription publication and the other technologies, we learned it from other cities and other governments as well. So this is a global network of civil service innovators who try to use this kind of thing to make our government around the world to be more open. So this is a collaboration rather than competition.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So it's good.
Yeah.
Okay,
awesome. Do you know about the Swedish legislation on public records?
A little bit, but not.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. If I ask for a document from a municipality, they must according to law leave it to the mayor to the
village. That's right. Yeah. Yeah. It's one of the pioneers of FLI.
Yeah. But you are more radical.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, I'm pushing a little bit.
Yeah, you're doing well.
Thank you.
So what is your next agenda?
My next agenda is to meet with a lobbyist.
Okay.
Who wants to abolish animal testing?
Right? Ah, okay, okay.
They say animal rights movement.
Ah, okay, okay, okay. But then you have to meet the industry as well.
Exactly. Yeah. So by making their points public, we tend to see that this is this could be framed instead of a zero-sum game as a development of simulation or AI technologies, a development of the biomed industry, and so on. Because if you can simulate part of the human organ, it is more precise than a mouse, right? Or and things like that. So it could be phrased in a way that is an innovation that is beneficial to the industries as well. And this is why the lobbying people are okay with me putting it on the radar, because they are not trying to take something away. They're trying to forge something that is a win for everyone.
But what is the general, when you are talking to an industrial lobbyist, for example, they mostly accept it. It's okay that you record it.
Yes, because you see, I'm a minister without a portfolio, meaning I don't have a ministry. So I don't really have any direct budget to allocate. All I can allocate is people's attention, right? Which is actually more scarce than capital in many. So of course they want to have the full context instead of just the slogans.
Yeah, okay, okay. Well, they see an advantage.
Yes.
Okay. So, okay.
Okay, okay.